Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the Corsair Dream League Season 10. I'm Eddie Pixel. I'm here with David Godsparker. And we are ready for one last game. That's right, one last game with myself and Gods. And not even a series, just a game. Just game one. As we are stepping into the land of Europe.
What if this game goes like 10 minutes? Do we get a second game then?
No.
Okay.
No, we're done. It's the last game.
So you guys hope for an 80-minute game.
You do, so you get to get the choice. Or maybe you don't like it.
Yeah,
maybe get rid of these fools.
Yeah, please.
I don't blame you. I totally empathize with you. But it's, yeah, we're going to hop into Europe. European Open qualifiers. We're into the semis. No, that's wrong. This is the finals. This is the grand final. Because Europe is only getting one open qualifier slot. Because the other three teams we have, of course, in the regional qualifiers are Parker, Liquid, Lithium, and the fantastic team that is.
Who got next place in Europe calls? It would have been...
I casted that. Who was it? Mango Bay. Which is... who's on Mango Bay again?
Bone 7.
That's the Bone 7 team. Yeah, you're right. So Mango Bay, Lithium, Liquid will be joined by one team from the Open Qualifiers, and it'll be one of these two teams. It's the Final Tribe versus...
Anticoagulation, or is that the team that's the team that lost?
Irene.
Oh, it's Irene, yeah.
Irene.
Yeah, whatever they were. A team of Czech Republic
players. Yeah, some new guys. So never seen these boys before, so excited to see what they're going to be able to do. The Final Tribe, that's not going to be an easy challenge for them, I don't think. Final Tribe, they've turned up to lands. Like, these guys, sure, they never really hit it off. They never really sort of got titles this year, last season. But I think they were sort of a strong new organization coming into Dota 2. I think they did a lot in terms of the sort of team image. You know, I thought they're a nice bunch of guys. They looked like a nice team, and I felt like they developed. They were this team that went from not qualifying to lands to getting to lands, coming in sort of last place, but then sort of improving their placement. So, and this season, as far as I'm aware, they didn't make any. It's the same team.
They made a change.
Oh, they did. Who did they change?
They brought in Chessy, right, and got rid of Pablo. So Eris missed the support, and
that's right.
Pablo
they made
was
one
out.
Change. So we'll see how that works out. I think Chessy's got a lot to show as a player. He's one of the old boys, you know, but was one of the big names, right? I believe back in Hon, you know, he's one of the Hon lads.
That's kind of Era and Frost, that's their background as well. So these guys know each other from Hon. A lot of them dominated the Hon scene for periods of time.
Yeah.
So we'll see. They should be heavy favorites going at least to me.
Absolutely. As I said, we don't really know too much about the other team, but that's why the Open Qualifiers are exciting, because these teams can sort of turn out of nowhere and give us an incredible show. So the game should be starting pretty soon, maybe around now. I believe we're in the lobby and we're just waiting for the draft to kick off. And again, as I say, this is the best of three. This is the finals, right? It's not the semis. Yeah, it's the finals.
It's the finals.
Is the finals.
Yeah, wonder if this goes through.
Yeah.
It was TFT. They beat Burton United, I believe, in the semifinals.
Yeah.
And then
Irene probably beat
Team Anticoagulation.
Yeah. You're correct.
So
I want to check as well, actually. Did TFT 2-0?
Yeah.
They did.
I don't know. I'm not. Yeah, that's against.
You're right. They did. Okay. Both of these teams two-o'd. In
are there any upsets earlier?
They have a big.
So Team Irene, their big upset was against the Polish boys. So not the full Polish team, because
No, but it was at least what two or three of the people from
three, maybe. It's
Exotic Deer,
Kato,
and Pados. So yeah, three of the Kinguin lads were in a team that did lose to Team Irene. So there we go. It's not Irene. It's eeriness. That makes more sense. I was like, "What is Irene?"
They capitalize, you know, that middle eeriness.
Eeriness.
I think it's because Erin, like the name Erin, ness. Maybe. I don't know. Maybe it means something in Czech. I'm gonna Google.
Yeah, I said not heard of this organization, but they got a logo. Hold you know, they got a logo, boys. They're official.
They fancy
eeriness. So we don't know what to expect from this. This is the finals of the Open qualifier. The winner of this is going to be able to play in the regionals and get to play against the big boys. Get to play against Team Liquid. Get to play against TI winners. We could see eeriness come out of nowhere and get the chance to show up Liquid in the regional qualifiers. It's exciting.
Nice. So eeriness is a Czech multi-gaming team founded on July 2006.
They've been around a long time. Well, they've been there. So mainly CSGO by the looks of it.
I'm just on the
go to the 2013 page. Oh.
that's
what mainly CSGO.
I don't know if they have a... They didn't have a page on Dota 2.
They didn't. So this... I mean, I've never heard of them in Dota 2. This must be their first sort of showing in Dota 2. So exciting. I mean, it's always nice. You know, Czech Republic org. They found themselves a Czech Republic team.
It's a beautiful country. Prague's a nice little city.
Oh, actually, no, I have been. I've been to Prague. I played a gig in Prague. Back when I was in the band, we went on the, there was this nice little, have you been to Prague?
Yeah.
You know, there's like a nice square with like a clock that does weird stuff, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's, I can't remember what he does, it does some special it's show. Oh, I got paid sound.
But yeah, Prague is beautiful. City, yes.
It's a great place. Great place to go and like visit the nice little bars. They've got some lovely little bars.
Yep.
They do indeed. Oh. And they have this museum. Did you go to the museum?
No, I didn't.
You have to be old to go to it. But I didn't go because I'm a polite boy. But apparently that's like a big tourist attraction in Prague. So if you're into that, no, visit Prague. There's a lot of exciting things going on there. So yeah, what have we got? We've got Tiny Phoenix opening for Irinis. And the chat for Final Tribe is the first pick. So, Irinis, what are they showing us so far? They're part of the meta. Wraith King. That hero, it's got nerfed a lot. Is it still second pick material? I don't know, gods.
That hero, they've been playing a lot on Frost. So, they're playing as a carry. I don't think this hero is very good as a three position.
But as a carry?
As a carry, it's definitely viable. It's still strong. It just needs more farm now because his spells used to carry him when he had less farm, but that's no longer the case so much.
All right. I'll be interested if they can make that Wraith King work, sort of the post-nerfs.
Yep. So they're probably doing Wraith King with Chen. Got a good setup for any Chen creeps you gank with. They're in, the Dire safe lane, I want to say. Is this Dire safe lane down here? Yeah.
I think the bans, of course, from Eeriness, the Lifestealer, not what we normally see, but if you're playing Tiny and Phoenix, it's good against them, and Lifestealer was, without a doubt, one of the carry heroes that Final Tribe were consistently picking.
And typical Wraith King things, you pick him up and you protect him by banning out those mana-burning heroes. No PL, no Weaver. There is Klinks still in the pool. Diffusal Klinks, very good against Wraith King. Strafe dodges his stun. You burn his mana.
Good against the Chen. Chomp on a bit of the Chen's pets.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, not
great in the laning stage because you're getting poked by Chen creeps and pre-level 6 is pretty rough. You can strafe dodge the Wraith King stuns, but there may be other stuff that you can't dodge. And there are ways like Wraith King can like cancel. He'll just keep animation canceling the stun. But that's also probably not an offlane thing. I think he's going to be more like
Frost is going to play that.
Yep.
Yeah, it's a Frost era.
So Tiny could go anywhere. I put him in the offlane for now, but we'll see where he ends up.
10 seconds remaining.
What are we going to see from our Czech Republic lads?
Who knows?
What else do you
draft? Draft Phoenix, maybe. What heroes are good there? Shaker, pretty good.
Enigma's still there.
Enigma.
It's a popular one with Phoenix. I mean, Wyvern's still there. No, it's not. Was banned. Just testing.
Void. Dark Willow with the Terror Rise can be pretty good with Phoenix.
I was going to say, actually, we've not seen any Dark Willow today.
There we go.
And you were bang on, yeah. I mean, you're absolutely bang on. Dark Willow is still a fantastic hero. I guess, CIS and, at least the teams we followed, had no interest at all. I don't think we've even seen a ban today of Dark Willow.
So,
but it comes out here in Europe.
Be in the off lane for Uranus. So up here.
10 seconds remaining.
I like it. I still think this hero is broken. Remaining. Pretty broke. He's broke.
Yep.
He's very
looking at down here. Getting my ups and downs wrong.
Silence up. Very good against, the Phoenix for obvious reasons with that curse in the lane and down the line. You know, any sort of time the Phoenix indicates he wants to fight with the egg, you pop the global, you take down the egg, you don't worry about your team being disabled. You're going to get the egg every time.
He's all silence. Too many S heroes. We need Ice Frog to diversify a bit more with these first letters.
It did sort of with Grimstroke, right? Are there many G heroes?
I don't think so. Gyro.
It's just Gyro, right?
Is it just Gyro?
I think it is diverse. There we go. I think there's only Gyro beginning with G. Yeah,
nothing else in the G section.
There we go. Thank you, Ice Frog. He watches he watches Dream League.
He's here for us.
He's watching right now. So chat, behave. Do not type any crazy suggestion for patch changes in the chat because Ice Frog might get influenced.
I'm going to put Silence in the offlane. I think he's a okay, kind of 4 or 5 position support. Go up there, spam some curse.
Yeah.
That's where the Phoenix is going to be going. Last word against Phoenix dive is like one of those direct counters. You can't dive away because you get silenced before you, and then you don't get to cancel it.
Interesting here for the side of Irinis. They get. Ooh, I've been saying this all day, haven't I? Axe Phoenix. Where's it been? Here it is. Axe Phoenix. Very, very strong combination.
Here he is. So that moves Tiny away from the offlane.
Now this is going to be...
Well, it'll be Axe Willow, actually, it looks like. Not Axe Willow. They're good together. Obviously, the combo you're talking about is more in the mid-game with the egg.
And there's the Clink's actually coming out in Final Tribe, son. So one of the ways to take down the egg.
Okay. And where is Clink's headed? Could be mid laner, could be... Don't think he'll be offlane, since that's the Wraith King. I don't think Wraith King wants to... I don't think you do Wraith King safe in Clink's as well.
And I know I've been saying it all day, but I want to see the Bloodseeker for Uranus. This is a Bloodseeker game. Maybe I've been in the EU mindset, you see.
Okay.
I don't know what these Czech Republic lads like to play. I'm telling you. Axe, Bloodseeker, Phoenix, but it...
Bloodseeker's...
Tiny Bloodseeker.
With Axe Willow, like, you've got this constant battle hunger spam and the Shadow Realm, you're just going to keep harassing them, so that's where Axe can really enable a hero like Bloodseeker. He's going to be sitting mid or safe lane and just getting all this thirst bonus damage.
I just want to see a Bloodseeker.
Could happen. Otherwise, yeah, Final Tribe want to mid that lane's... Sorry, they were... Eeriness, I think, want to mid that lanes against Clink's. Final Tribe probably looking for their off-laner.
Oh, did they ban the Zeus? Because they're picking the Bloodseeker! Come on, boys. I know my Czech Republic lads.
Huh.
Well, Bloodseeker will win you the game here. Final Tribe, back to them. What are they going to ban? They might ban the Bloodseeker. I'm telling you. They know what's up. These guys know what's up.
You don't have anything that hits buildings right now. Tiny's like, if you're killing people,
he's pretty good down the lane. They hit Tiny, he pushes buildings.
So. Dire team pick. They ban
the Brood.
Okay. Brood good against Clink's. I think you're looking at that. Like, melee heroes, like, you don't want to go for like some range right clicker against Clink's.
Final Shrub, what do they take?
Gotta pick first, so. Something to lane with Silencer, harass hero, maybe. Don't have to get initiated when you've already got the Wraith King. Could just go for some kind of strong range duo with Silencer.
I mean, could they put the Wraith King in the offlane and just whack a Drow in to finish it off?
They could. I don't like the Wraith King in that three position role so much, but. It's doable. What do you think? I think they, with the Axe Willow, it's like they've got this great offlaner. They're going to crush that lane. They should maybe focus on getting saying that's just going to scale better, take objectives, because any hero that rotates to that lane is going to be able to do a lot. You've already got this Axe Willow who are going to put tremendous amounts of pressure on wherever they go. And TFT are probably thinking, like, well, we can't win that lane. Let's try and make sure our offlane with the Silencer can do well.
Radiant team.
Sorry. Okay, Sinter. You know, it's like we don't know these teams. Honestly. There's so many heroes that can work right now. It's
if Uranus don't pick a Bloodseeker, they're crazy.
So Sinter will be the offlane. So Sinter Silencer. Could be Sinter Chen, but I'm not feeling it.
If they don't pick, honestly, they don't pick Bloodseeker, they've just lost.
They're not picking Bloodseeker. It's against Clink's. Oh, actually, against Clink's is not terrible.
Dude, it's Bloodseeker with Dark Willow.
They're gonna pick like
with the Terror Eyes with Axe.
They're gonna pick like Lina.
No. Bloodseeker, come on, boys, listen to me here. Bloodseeker is the hero that you're missing in your life right now.
I'm putting Lina down.
Give us the blood. Give us the Seeker of Blood. No.
Tinker.
Oh, they lost. GG, boys. Final Tribe, game one, in the bag. Tinker?
Yeah.
Why pick a Tinker? They got a Clink's. They got to hunt you down. They got a Silencer. Not a fan.
What?
I'm not a fan. You like the Tink?
What have they got to catch him? I haven't actually looked at this game from a Tinker's eyes.
They got.
Wraith King does nothing to you. Clink's not amazing because he's hot. It doesn't find you in trees. Sinter Axe, I guess you've got that pathing that you can use to your advantage, but it feels like a good Tinker
you
game.
Love the
mist against the Clink's is really good. Well. In lane as well as just in the game as a whole. Anytime you get gone on, you just instantly laser him. So until Clink's gets a Hex, doesn't really have that kill potential.
All right, prediction time. I'm sorry, you picked a Tinker, not a Bloodseeker. I've got to go with Thine Tribe anyway. They are the favorites here in this matchup, and I don't believe that's a good Tinker game, sir.
I think it's a good Tinker game, but I'll go with Final Tribe.
Yeah, I'm going to go.
I don't know this guy, so I'm not going to put blind faith in them as much as I think their draft is just fine.
Do we know what MMR they are? Can we see that? Sure. Do we get to see? We see that when they're in game, can't we? We'll be able to check that. I want to see what rank these guys are. I imagine, because I've just never heard of them. I wonder if they are on like the leaderboards. Because sometimes you do see sort of these players in high positions.
They're in finals of Europe qualifiers. I'm sure they're at least top 500 players.
I'd say top 1,000. No, actually, yeah.
They're carrying mid.
You're right. If they're getting to this
carry
point,
mid have to be like top 200, I think.
Yeah.
They may have a support who's like top 500 to 800 or something, or 1,000, like you say.
Neither of us won the last prediction, of course. Yeah, but I didn't, though. Like, I had Na'Vi, but it was not Na'Vi. So I shouldn't get a point for that. I'm going to be honest. I shouldn't get a point for that. I went with Na'Vi because I thought they had a different draft. Yeah. So I went with the wrong draft. So I will not cheat the system. I'm an honest boy. So no points for either of us on that last game. But this game, as we said, we're both predicting the final tribe should be able to take it.
They're going to get more games than us. You know, we're at a disadvantage.
Will they get more games?
We've got to go for prediction percents almost. So what are you looking
at?
Phoenix.
Oh, yeah, weapons. Can we hover on the profiles? Does it show the medals on the scoreboard? I can't remember if it does in these games.
No.
Oh. I guess that's a no.
That's a stop asking for too much.
That's a no.
You've messed
sorry.
Up.
I'm sorry. I won't ask for these things again. Look, I'm sorry. Yeah. Just show us the game of Dota, please. I'm sorry.
This is the game of Dota unfolding in front of us. Just need to animate some creeps coming out.
Come on, where's the game? Maybe Weppus is checking if we can see their medals. I want to see how good these boys are. See if they have what it takes to take down the. Final Tribe is still a full. Just restarting the game, boys. We're just fixing some bugs.
Okay.
Some features.
What was their name?
You could check it out, right? Yeah.
I'm going to give them the old Google search.
Teams. There they are. Perfect. Let's do some research, boys. Let's see how many games the Tinker he's got. Is he a dirty Tinker spammer?
Who's their mid? We don't even know, do we? We don't know who picked it up.
So Curry?
Curry's their carry. He's, let's see, pub profile.
Yep, that's the one we want.
Gyro Smith.
Here we go, the big reveal.
514, well, that's lower than I expected.
Rank 514.
So I think Muff is their mid. Nope, he's a support.
On what rank's he? Check the pub.
I was going to check them.
Oh, you're going to check.
Invoke.
There you go.
Supreme. This guy's core mid lane.
Supreme's playing the Tinker.
This is the one guy who I think I've seen his name.
Okay.
Rank 125.
Rank 125, what's the Tinker win rate? He's got 500 games on it, though. That's a lot of games.
Yeah.
There's a lot of games. Saberlight. Who's this guy? This is the offlaner.
Yep.
Let's check this. We're doing our investigations here live on stream. Hot rank 164.
Okay.
Same not bad. Not bad at all. And this lad here.
Four position players. Unranked.
Uncalibrated. But does have 7.2K. So that actually put him in the top 100, I think. That's pretty high.
Yep.
They're pretty much top 200. They've got one 500 player, but he's the support. But the cores, the...
No, the carry was 500. Their five position is ranked 764. Their carry was lower than expected.
Okay.
Yeah. Sometimes you just get some bad streaks.
But the Tinker was, he was up there. He was in top 300, right? Oh, mid lane, Chess, Supreme. It's all kicking off already. Both getting very low. Salve's going to be cancelled. He gets the range for that Searing Arrow. That's going to mean the Chessie himself is going to be able to salve up half that HP advantage in this mid lane already. Let's see.
Yeah, I think Tinker's the guy you look to. He's the high MMR player. He's playing Tinker. He's got a pretty good matchup for himself.
Yeah.
And he's the guy who called this hero as his last pick. Typically, it is like the player saying, yep, this is a good game for this hero. Brings out double salve since he knows he's going to get harassed a lot. See how things progress for him. So go through that first salve.
That's the second salve.
Second salve.
Yeah, he got the first one cancelled. Yeah. So he's already.
But as we've seen that. Courier too.
That has been the way to play, you know, recently in mid. Just make sure you constantly have that HP. If you're having to waste time waiting for a courier when you get low, you're losing the lane.
Yep.
So get as much of it out. It's better to have too much than too little as the mid laner nowadays in terms of consumables.
Gets the range creep deny. Nicely done by the Tiny. Not the support lane allocations I expected with TFT. I thought Chen would be safe lane with Wraith King and Silencer off lane, but this works fine. Both of the supports are pretty good at securing lanes. Silencer is going to be a better ranged harasser against the Axe Willow. The curse against these heroes that want to spam spells can just be pretty nice. Jesse needs some more salves, it looks like. Courier currently in use, but will be available soon. And just pesky haste rune, making it a bit harder to get those efficient harass trades in.
Third salve.
Pretty even.
On the Tinker.
Yeah, it slightly Klinks faded maybe with the regen exchange, but likely we'll see Klinks have to bring out another salve, so that'll kind of make things a bit more even once again. And Tinker's trying to not buy another salve. He wants this bottle. He wants to get that instead of the salve. Because he won't get that last hit, so actually going to be struggling to get there.
Oh, on top.
Axe pretty good against these Wraith King skeletons. Part of the reason they picked the hero.
Oh, and Curry. First blood down bottom as he gets in.
Yeah. The tree throw finished it off because he wasn't even near the dead body. Another Wraith King stun could spell the death of the Willow, but will not chase for it.
That's how it's with the Shadow Realm. Didn't get the hit off. But it gives the time for Axe to regen back up to full, get himself back in the lane and back partying with the Wraith King and the Silencer.
Yeah, getting some good harass it. And see how these lanes now develop. The first blood being picked up, but Tiny's out of kind of regen, it looks like, down here. Just the one Tengu left, so even though he got this first blood, he's in a very difficult spot where he can't quite secure the lane. Phoenix diving over. What was he doing? It almost looked like he was going for bounty runes. He's going to get the bottom regen rune. I guess he had the ward top, so he knew the rune spawn bottom.
Curry. Yeah. He's in trouble.
Gonna juke in the trees.
They're going in.
Get the TP in. Your inventory doesn't have mana yet, but he might soon.
Oh, those jukes, though, is it enough? It doesn't look like it. Oh,
six Falling Blade is way out of this.
He is dead. Yeah. They get him.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. I think he could have used his Falling Blade to do some more fancy juking there, like from behind the tower, rather than just going out the obvious way. You can kind of Quelling Blade your way through those trees on the left. Definitely was an opportunity to live there, but would have been difficult. But hey, end of the day, actually healing up and coming back to lane is going to net him a kill. Nets his Phoenix a kill, but that's sometimes dying is honestly for the better. Come back to lane, you're that much stronger.
A mid lane, Chaz?
Yeah, no points in Invis just yet. The regen rune.
Oh, the dream. Ooh. Tinker, get a bit of free harassment out there. No cost at all to himself. My thrift reward. Yep. As top lane, the curse ticks down the kill, same time. He's diving, and bam, he's got it. Saberlight.
Yep, miss micro the Tengu went through, and Axe gets a nice little kill for himself. Made a bit easier by the Wraith King, and bounty runes are up. We'll see if people are going to go pick these up. They haven't been claimed as of yet. Axe could buy a bottle, but I don't think he wants to. Not really. He'll just slow down his Vanguard, which is so important, the timing on that item. If you want to get a Vanguard, you want to make sure you get it by like 6 or 7 minutes if possible. Even like the 8-9 minute Vanguards are just going to be so making you so hard to deal with in lane.
Correct.
Yep.
Getting some of the creeps in. Taking away some of that Chen army. Okay, so 1k lead at the moment for Eeriness.
Yeah, they're doing well. All three of their cores having a good game and good lane so far.
Trying to dive in again for Curry, but it's hard every time they do try and do so. The Phoenix is constantly there with the Fire Spirits.
Back at mid, Tinker, his lane's still not going great, getting Outlast hit fairly significantly by Klinks, and that was even with the help of a regen rune.
No. Radiant are scanning.
A bit of a threat coming in here down bottom. I'm going to leave Frost alone on this Wraith King up top, just prioritizing this bottom lane a bit more. Bouncer is still lingering, but doesn't really feel like he's trying to pressure the lane. He's just going for these side pulls. Denying XP, getting some last hits for himself. The Shrine? Klinks? Jesse? That's a unfortunate.
Yeah, makes a rotation from mid and ends up just giving his life away to the safe lane.
Yep. More TPs coming in.
Yeah, they're going to chase down for another here, see if they can get this chat. Down goes the maze. He's going to walk straight into the first route. Curry. See if he can get in close for the combo. Finds the avalanche onto the two of them. In fact, tossed there as well as the Chen gets taken down by a tree.
Might get more here.
They're going to get all three of them.
That's
the cursed crown.
They kind of, it looked like the Chen was trying to like stay there and bait them in, but yeah, he didn't really have good backup. Just the Centaur and Tiny with the mana for a full combo. Able to get the kills and even got the toss damage on both heroes. So nicely played.
Mid lane, with that time that he sort of spent moving around to the bottom chest, he gave a Tinker chance to sort of start to catch up top lane. Try and go on to Saberlight, as you say that. Spinning certainly deals with the skeletons. In fact, he's trying to turn and get a bit aggressive onto the Silencer here. Yeah. Feeling confident. The stun will be thrown out.
These raindrops, he's so tanky. That 1100 health is like 50% more than that because he's just blocking nuke after nuke. Oh!
Early with the dunk.
Mistimed it ever so slightly.
Man, he's going to die with that. Straight up misplay there from the Axe.
Yeah, he needed to just get one more right click in first, it looks like. It's tough. You're like clicking them. Maybe you see him underneath the threshold by a health or two, and then he heals it in the time, the cast time or whatever it is.
We'll see the rotation from Hanscan did get the kill onto the Tinker. Phoenix. And he'll lose his life. In fact, he ends up getting both of them.
Oof. Okay.
Hanscan with that rotation, picking up a double kill. Causing issues here. It's the same time down bottom. Curry!
Curry's just owning.
He is. He's 4-1-2 on this Tiny. Absolutely trashed in this bottom lane.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Well, that puts, honestly, right now, Eeriness in a slight edge. Axe misplaying a little bit up top, I think, particularly before your Vanguard comes online. You should be playing a bit more cautiously, but even so, he's going to be a pretty happy camper. Does not have Call, so going to take a lot of damage from the Klinks right clicks, and Jesse will find that kill. This is rough. You know, you have this great early game start, you have this scary dual lane that just wins your lane, and then you die a couple times around this stage before you have your Vanguard. It can be very costly. And it often makes Klinks, Axes kind of reconsider, like, do I still go Vanguard or do I just get my Blink? Because the Blink gets slowed down as a result of this Vanguard coming out much slower.
So the Janet trying to make a bit of a play.
He juked the hell out of them.
He absolutely did. They're in the totally wrong neighborhood. They're not even close. As he's out of there, they're not spotting him at all.
Yeah. He's outplayed.
Are scanning.
Hanskin. I assume that's Hanskin. I don't know. I don't think Air is the Chen player.
Yeah, Hanskin's on the champ.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
It's still pretty deep.
He's just trying to protect his ward. He's like, you guys want to deward me? I'm going to be here. Meanwhile, top. Axe trying to get another dunk off here. Doesn't quite have the damage for it. And Wraith King has ultimate.
He's got the heal from the sun, right? Obviously not too much at this moment in time at the early level.
That looked like a level one sunray. In terms of damage output. Oh, two. Okay. Regeneration. Not much healing coming from it. Silencer will get the experience tome for the dire side. And we'll see where things go. This Chen just living in the enemy jungle here. The center nearby as well. If they can stampede on in, the death of that Tinker. He needs to be very careful. Good position to be in.
They're a little low here, these two. Jonas and Van leaning straight in with the Stampede, looking to find the position for the Who Stomp. Gets it onto the big kill. Gets the Tinker. You've got the Stomp as well from the Centaurs with the Micro. Hanskin finds the setup for his second. Double kill for Jonas and Van. Picked up with his rotation with TFT towards the mid lane and a tier 1 tower as well. They're trying to put the pressure in on top, but the Wraith King backs up. He's still got the Reincarnate to rely on. And the TP in from the Silencer. We'll push back the Axe and the Phoenix.
Very nicely done, and nice little tower secure from Curry bottom. He's getting very close to a fast Blink Dagger here. That's going to be...
He's getting a lot of space.
Yeah, that's going to be something that can really empower his Tinker just to get a lot of room to farm, find kills as well with the setup. Willow needs to hit this level 6, though. It feels like he's just lacking that extra bit of damage and utility for his team.
Uh-oh. He just walked into the wrong neighborhood, son.
We'll survive through the initial damage.
See if the creeps can finish him off. Oh, they won't. And indeed, they're going to turn. They're going to take that kill onto the Chen. Oh, he does actually still tick down as Chessie will be able to get the touch in from the back. And in fact, the Chen's still alive, but Curry's there to clean up the kill. Turns up on the high ground, and certainly there's a nasty surprise there for Hansken. Hansken's army still going to work, but they'll clean it up. More money into the bank for Eeriness.
Yep.
But overall, TFT do maintain that net worth lead, only by 1k.
Yeah, they've kind of bounced back after not the best laning stage. These kills on the Tinker are so important to slow down his boots of travel, and the kills on the Axe slowing down his itemization as well. So they're not just fighting these kind of low important support kills. It's core after core going down. Chessy scouted out by the sentry.
They see him.
Okay. He thought he had one more right click before needing to egg.
He egged way too late. And now they're going to pay the price for some more lives.
Yep.
Oh dear.
Silence is going to get them at least one more, it looks like. Not both.
Well, at least the Tinker will be able to TP out, but a bit of a misplay there, as that was Irinus totally choosing to take that fight. They dove in, they popped the dust, but then Chassis turns and kills him with the DD. It's a scary Klinks.
Yeah, it was a bit deceptive. It almost looked like he was going to survive one more right click before the egg, and you want to kind of... He was just going for that maximum efficiency play, where if he gets one more right click before he eggs, you know, that maybe is strafe wearing off so his egg doesn't die to the strafe. Yeah, it definitely can make a difference. Can he find a toss?
He's got it in a few seconds, but I think Jonas and fans should doesn't be finding out of vision.
Vision, yeah. Oh. No, it doesn't.
We'll just go for the chain instead.
Yeah, why not?
Quick toss to hold hand scan in place, and hand scan will get taken down. More money for Curry. Radiant's top tower has fallen. Still the farm just a little bit better as the game progresses here for the final tribe.
Amulet up on the Wraith King. See where he goes next. Probably see a Blink Dagger, I want to say.
Yeah, no Midas Blink. Or Radiant sort of first up.
I think Blink then Radiant sounds okay. Pretty good. Always a good Blade Mail game when you're versing Tinker. But Radiance is nicer as Tinker too, just because of the Radiant's ability to stop his Blink Dagger and all that. Same against like the Axe, the Tiny. They're going to have two, probably three Blink Daggers up, so. You hear that's getting kited around as a Wraith King, and Radiance allows you to do damage while you're being kited.
Curry in again onto Chest. The Supernova drop tower's got to get himself away, but Curry's hot on the hunt. It's been silenced though, so won't be able to go any further. Hans can bring in the army on the side. He's going to be spotted out by the Phoenix. The Phoenix does have to dive forward as he looks to slow down Hans can. Some rays there as well. Not quite enough damage. The Stampede comes into play. As Hans can be able to get himself out. Curry's in trouble. The wraparound comes through from the Wraith King, and they'll get the kill before the Terrorize is out and down. So Curry taken out. Streaks ended by Frost as he picks up the payday. Still.
That was on the Phoenix. He went diving for an extra kill. He's like, oh, I've got my spell. I just came out of egg. Let's dive for this. But he dives in. Tiny couldn't blink. His blink was getting canceled by Chen Creeps. So, end result is that this Tiny's kind of overcommitted as a result of the Phoenix. And it's one of those mistakes that you wouldn't really see out of that kind of upper echelon of teams, but just a small bit of sloppiness coming in.
Starting to invade the jungle now.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
What are they going to find? They reveal themselves onto an illusion. Do have eyes on the Tinker. He's got the laser.
Yep. Very quick on it, too.
Now we keep him safe.
Yeah, Klink's actually couldn't wait any longer. There was a sentry right on top of him, so he was spotted right away there. And it seems like he knew it as well. Structures are fortified. Radiant
structures are fortified. On top lane, Sableye.
It's good. He hasn't got his blink, and he's taking this tower here. He's going to get him that blink just that little bit faster, and with this creep wave as well, that should be
pretty much that.
Yep. Depends on his spins and last hits. He got two out of the four. No, missed the range group. Oh, no.
Uh-oh.
Okay, he's not there.
No. Yeah, he's got to go to the neutrals.
Last hitting with stuff like spin and like jug crit can be so annoying. Sometimes you're like, oh, I'm going to get this last hit, and then you just mistime a crit or a spin.
You could have de-aggro the creep so you can get CS. He was hoping for
the efficient play where he found it quicker so he can go buy the blink. And, you know, it's like by trying to be more efficient,
Sure, we'll let him off. But there is that blink. Let's see what sort of plays he can make, Curry. He's going for that Echo Saber after the Blink Dagger. Jonas and Fam finds himself the Tinker. Inside the jungle, they invade. They look to get out, but there's the jump forward. It gets the call onto two. Perfect play from Sableye as he looks to set up for two kills in return for losing the Tinker. They are trying to chase down this Sentinel, but he's already out of range of the Supernova. They'll only get the one in return. Shadow Realm hits going to be there onto Era, but no further control. As the final tribe only lose the chin for getting the Tinker, a trade that they'll happily take.
Yeah, the Stinker's dying a few times here, getting hunted very effectively by TFT, in large part due to their Observer Ward. It's a very common spot that just hasn't been dewarded yet. Looks like Willow finally dewards it. That ward kind of was up there for a little bit too long. I think that's such a common spot against Tinkers who want to farm jungle.
So what can find
happening. Want to get Jesse, but doesn't get rooted.
No, he's out at the roots. And he gets sent back as well for extra safety. Playing it safe here as Irinus show a large amount of their team appearing in that middle lane. Bottom lane, Centaur, Jonas and Fan out of range. Doesn't want to stick around for the fight. Tinker Twelve Engine towards that Blink Dagger. Still trying his best to catch up. As we can see, all three cores of TFT are the top three in the network for the moment. They're relatively close behind that of Irinus, but still as a whole, 4K difference between these two teams at the moment.
Illusion.
Nice little rune for Axe, getting those illusions. And the best here is to have this rune on early on in the game to farm with and see if they want to make any kind of a big smoke play. There we go. They don't have the egg up just yet, but I think it should be coming online fairly soon. Yeah, 5 seconds, so that's why they're making this go. And that should be able to catch anyone and force a fight pretty easily. Not Wraith King. He's probably one target you don't want to go on with the reincarnation. They're going to smoke and smoke.
Yeah. Okay. So you're going to get the jump. That's the question. Stabilite, does he want to do it? He's thinking about going for it, and he does. And he does manage to get the catch onto the silencer. Terrorize coming down as well. In fact, he's able to catch onto the two of them. Can they kill that silencer off in time before the ult comes out? They can. That's going to be the silencer gone. Stampede comes out. Won't save the silencer. As now Chessy will try and turn towards Stabilite, but he keeps his distance. Jump forward here from the Wraith King, trying to find the stun onto a target, but Curry's now on the high ground. Turns with the avalanche, the armor's already toggled on, so the Wraith King's got more than enough strength. Yonos and Fan tries to go in for the quick hoof stomp, but the Blink Out's already out there as they're escaping. They're running away, Irinus. Chessy's still got his eyes onto the Clinks. He gets the cool off that extra armor, and then the laser will keep him safe. Sableye survives.
Support for support. Bit unlucky for Phoenix that he just happened to egg by an Invis Clinks who just strafes and very easily kills the egg. He could have egged on top of the Axe call, but I think he wanted to, you know, do it a bit safer. He did by where the Ancients were. He was like, okay, it's safer, I'm further away. Nah, Klinks is just there in this. Which, yeah, you know, sometimes that just happens. It was unfortunate, unlucky more than anything. And then, yeah, bit of a nullified fight thanks to the egg going down. There wasn't any kind of second win from Eeriness, and Tiny was also... They'd only smoked with, what, three heroes or even two, so that Tiny wasn't
That was a bit funky.
Quick fingers.
Yeah, he got the blink out just before that call sort of came out at the end of the animation. Very quick.
Had the Radiance queued up, but buys a blade mail. I think that's fine. You're against Tinker.
Yeah.
Tiny combos, Willow. Willow's actually very good against that hero because you're not going to want to go in with your Bedlam.
Curry nearly having that Echo Saber. Very close. 400 gold and it will be there for him. And the Tinker, of course, climbing into the game as it were. You know, sure, the opponents have that edge. He's getting the space, he's got his Blink and his bots, and this is where the farm really starts to speed up. If he's not getting punished, if he's not getting hunted down. He's done three times so far this game. But it's going to be that little bit harder to catch now. He's going to be jumping around the lanes, jumping around the jungle. And there we have an Echo Saber done, so pretty much I guess the Centaur and the Wraith King is still going to be hard targets for Curry to go on and have the hope of bursting alone, but the other three, they're certainly there for the taking if he gets on top of them with a Blink. He'll be able to burst them down in the combo, no problem.
We'll see if they get brave for another fight. I think he's probably looking like he wants his level 12. That egg, that second point just gets so much harder to kill. Also careful to have sentries. You need eyes on Clinks because you want to make sure that egg is quite far away from him.
Top lane, they get the call.
I don't know if they've got the damage.
He's got a pipe.
Not even close. And that's fine. Like they were setting up hoping for a different hero to appear. They didn't really commit that much to it or anything. No ultimates, just a blink call, and you know Tinker's gonna be happy. Doesn't really carry TPs anywhere. Here comes the old Wraith King, level 15, so he's got that nice boost in health. It's very hard to deal with the plus 15 strength, the armlet, the blade mail. He's a very tanky frontliner.
Does jump across, but the dive away is there.
Radiant are scary.
There, he'll go for the call. Does manage to get himself on top of the target. The Global Silence comes out. There's the counterplay with the Bling Hoot Stomp from Jonas and Fat. He's training on top of them, but so's Curry. They get the dunk off as well. That's the Clink's gone. Terrorize down onto the Centaur. Stun sending back. Call once again from the Axe, trying to pull him more. The Shadow Realm hit comes out onto the Chen. Chen, he'll fall down. The Supernova out as well. They're trying to kill it off, but they've got to back off. They're not going to get the chance to do so, though, because Curry, in with the toss, holds the Silencer in place. As the Silencer will tick down to the Fire Spirits, no escape for error. As three dead on the final tribe. The Wraith King, he's going to pop as well. The Reincarnate in play will give him a second chance. Jonas Advance trying to fight back against his Phoenix Titanbeat as well. Can he get in close? He cannot. The Phoenix escapes. The call from Saberlight holds back the Centaur. They've taken four of the final tribe, only losing the Tinker Eeriness. A 4-for-1 team fight in favor of the Czech Republic.
Somehow, the Phoenix just doesn't die there. He's just a sliver of health. The entire fight has heroes on top of him chasing, and it's just like help after help. The laser first for some added misses, then there was an axe call. Every little bit of stun and disable to save the Phoenix. Unfortunately, they lose a more important hero while all that's going on with the Chen creeps and the mayhem. That was the Tinker, but amazing team fight. They just played so well. I think something that was underestimated by TFT was actually the tiny status resistance. He got unsilenced faster than they all expected because he threw off an Avid Toss combo probably way early. Klynx was standing his ground, not backing off, and
Oh, right,
they go straight in. They know some of these ultimates are down, so they want to fight. And it's only the Phoenix deck, so they also know they're, you know, just being sneaky. This is a very fast, unexpected play.
No questions asked.
I think that's just, you know, happened too fast. They showed Centaur mid, so it's like, okay, you know, Centaur's mid, they just respawned. You know, nothing's going on, right?
Yep. Well, they might jump for this then. Kari.
Quick, easy kill.
Burst the silencer. Can they get anything more? Doesn't look like it. They keep the distance, not wanting to jump on Chessy with his Aegis. They don't want to mess around with that one. Mid lane, Kari. Starting to push in. Tier 1 tower still there, standing for the final tribe at the moment.
Easy pickup for Eeriness. Kari's got the tree charges to bring this down fairly quickly, and the march laid out. Rotation's coming in, though. They may want to at least contest this one.
Jumpstone, quick blink to dodge it from Kari. Tower still alive for now for final tribe.
Yeah, at this point, they're in position to defend it. Even just getting a deny would be great, but it doesn't even look like that's going to be necessary. Bounty runes coming up soon. Chessy grabs a creep. We'll secure them. Oh, Tinker.
Oh, they found him. They've caught him. They've killed him.
Too many deaths on Supreme. Trying to do too much. Yeah. Like, dying for a bounty rune is definitely not a good cause. And we've seen these constant pickoffs. And you can see the tips there in Hanskin. He's getting credited for a lot of these catches and definitely has been fantastic on Chen. His creep micro is just one of the best as far as Chen players out there.
That's heading to push mid, the final tribe. Push, they certainly will with this Klynx. Taking down this tier 2 tower at very impressive speed. No way that Eeriness can look to try and stop them taking tier 2s for now. They'll try and look for the split push otherwise. You've got bottom lane Kari. He's onto a tier 2 himself, but there's the jump. The stomp from Jonas from Fan buying. Time for TPs to come through. Kari tries straight away for the immediate TP out, but he's not going to make it. Yule Scepter's there. As the TP's cancelled, he's held back. And with the TP rotation of the two of the final tribe, Frost and Error will help clean up the kill.
No more int going the way of the silencer. Nicely done finding these kills.
But still, it's sure, you know, you've got the final tribe with that lead. But that lead's pretty much stuck around the 3K mark for quite some time. You know, they're keeping up with the pace.
Yep.
Eeriness.
Yeah, guys, put together a few more team fights like we saw mid lane where, you know, get a good jump with the axe, followed up with a supernova or a tiny combo, and try and use those spells quickly before the global comes in. So, you know, if supernova's already down and your tiny axe have used their initiation spells, like you're blowing someone up and the fight likely has already gone your way. He needs to be careful, getting caught by things like Arcane Curse. His positioning is just so crucial in these fights. He's got the 4-staff queued up, opting for a defensive item.
Dire's top tower. Okay.
I'm just feeling he's... This will give him like some sort of bit more sense of invulnerability around these
Radiant's
fights.
Bottom tower is
but
under attack.
Not hugely solid. I don't feel like this is a game where it's like a must-buy at all. He's probably just a bit rattled and feeling the pressure because he has made some mistakes getting caught out against a draft that hasn't got the best Tinker catch, has some.
Ooh.
Tinker. Oh, Siri, me.
Oh.
Somehow.
Does get the rearm blink off, yeah. And he's actually going back in, starting to lay down more march to the machines. TPs are coming through, though, so he's got to be careful. Blinks away once more. And back out to base he goes. He's out of there. There's going to be a dive up in a second for the Phoenix, so he should be fine, too. Gets himself out of range. The Ray Fire Blast goes for the Sunray TP out across the trees, and he's gone. They get themselves away from the final charge response.
Well, not losing anyone there. We'll be pretty happy with that. Game remaining that like 3-4
Okay.
He's found again.
They've caught him once more.
This Yule Scepter is such a great pickup this game.
Yeah.
Such an unconventional item, but
really finding, messes with the Tinker.
Yeah, and bottom lane, when we saw him get the Blink stun off, and he was like, oh, I'll TP out. But Tiny was like, didn't actually check his items, gets caught by the Yules, couldn't TP out at all. And the other massive reason to always buy Yules is when you're versing Axe. One of your right-click carries gets called by a Blade Mail Axe, you want to instantly Yules the Axe, so you save them, essentially. So, very, very good item this game, and being used very well.
Radiance.
Level 18. This is Heroes.
Oh, he's
so
big. He's
right
beefy.
Now.
Jumping in, looking for the Hoof Stomp. Yonis and Fan won't quite find it. The Terrorize down. We'll start sending the Wraith King back for a little bit, but Chessy doesn't get caught in it. Continues to push on with the Searing Arrows. He's taken the Tier 3 Terror. Now the Rack's in trouble as well. Still 5 seconds before Tinker's back in, and it's not going to be soon enough to hold onto these Rack's as TFT. We'll find the melee Racksmith. There's the jump. It does get the call onto the two of them, Sableye. They've got the damage to burst them down. Global Silence comes out in response from Era. They've got the stun onto the Axe. Sableye in trouble. Gets nuked down by the Double Edge. Axe is out for 50.
Central TFT blink away with the stun, so.
Not only getting a kill, but also getting that melee Racks. And the Radiant Courier.
Yeah, a little bonus. Why not? We'll take that. Says TFT. Not a convincing game from them. It's still not over by any means, but I've definitely seen a lot of promise out of this Eeriness team. Just a few small sloppy mistakes, Tinker getting caught out, and just some of their teamfight execution hasn't always been on point, but still a close game, still winnable.
Oh no, yes, poor Phoenix.
Yep, finding these kills.
Got to press that supernova quick, and even if you die, I guess you still die there.
And BKB TP out, playing it safe. Didn't actually have his skeleton walk, or he may have just, you know, tried to back out.
To 18. It's an 8k advantage. I don't know how they're going to kill this Wraith King, especially once he gets the heart.
Yeah. It's like, you kill him once, can you really kill him a second time? Probably not. And you've got to kill him a second time in that small 35-second window.
They're going to check there. They don't see him at the moment. They don't see the axe. They're going to just continue to head across. They do see the Dark Willer. They do come back to check now, but Axe is already out of there.
Yep.
Radiant are scanning.
Fortunately, for Axe does not get caught out.
Mid lane Curry did have a good impact to start, but sort of slowed down in terms of finding kill opportunities. Despite his quick beginnings on Tiny, it's really starting to slow down now for him.
I think both Axe and Tiny are kind of feeling the lack of presence from the Tinker. Like, these pickoffs on Tinker has forced Tinker just to play more conservatively, play in his jungle. And these are heroes at the stage of the game where they need a Tinker follow-up to get kills.
Oh, you got to be careful here, Phoenix. Yeah. Chessy on the hunt, leading the way in. They'll drop a sentry. They do get the call off, but straight in reaction there. Have they got the backup to kill Chessy in time? No, Chessy's got the BKB, the stun onto the Phoenix. Means there's no egg for now. He'll go down. The Axe as well falls. There's been a buyback from the Phoenix, so they want to buy back more for the fight. The Phoenix is dead straight away. He buybacks TPs, gets stunned immediately by Jonas and Fans Hoofstomp. As they've lost him, he's on a dieback, Curry. He's trying his best, but the micro is there from Hansken, looking for the body blocks here with the Centaur. Curry will be able to get up with the Shadow Blade. As Jonas and Fan, he's still looking for more. Gets the stun onto this Dark Willow, but the cool counterplay will be there. Sableye dragging Jonas and Fan up to the high ground. He's able to force himself down and away from Curry's combo. They do hold in some sort of sense, but still.
Oh, that's a lot of damage on that tier 3.
It is. Now top lane getting shoved in by the final tribe. Because with those buybacks coming into play as a failed attempt at trying to heavily turn the fight, sure they push them back. But the net worth lead ever increasing for Final Tribe. With those sort of unfavorable trades continue to happen for Eeriness.
Yeah. Final Tribe kind of waiting and lingering around this Roche pit, just knowing that they can secure that very easily. Oh dear.
Oh.
Got the scout with the sentry, and yeah, we'll get back to safety.
No messing around here for this Tinker. He has to be hot on the blink. Yep. And this Klinks is around and hunting for him.
Yeah, I can imagine. Klinks will be looking for something.
Yeah.
Oh, it goes for Orca. I was thinking like a scythe for that kind of a scenario. Or at least like maybe an MKB.
Oh, and Klingz does start to try and find mid, but there's the jump straight away. Sableye with the setup. Chesty pops the blink dagger, but the dunk's there from Axe.
Just enough damage.
A little bit too greedy there, trying to farm mid lane aggressively, and look, they're trying to set up for more. They Yule's up
this
the Wraith King.
This is not an easy kill.
Can they get away with this one? Yonison Fan again jumping in, stopping that Phoenix being able to cast a single spell, and now with the Stampede, they're ready to chase down for more, slowing down the Axe. With the Stampede, Wraith Fire Blast holds him in place as the double edge from Yonison Fan picks up a second. On the side, Era finishes off the Dark Willow, and they're not done yet. Yonison Fan trying to hunt for more. The Shadow Blade will keep Curry safe, as he's able to walk away, but now three dead on Eeriness. Neither the Axe or the Phoenix having buyback available, and again, Phoenix getting caught out at the start of every single one of these fights. Meaning that there's no supernova or no sort of big team fight turnaround play available. As mid lane, Yonison Fan clean up the range racks. See if they can find anything more with this good 1 minute where there's no Axe to worry about. The completed heart is done on Frost Wraith King.
Yikes, he's unkillable, really. 4.5k health with Armlet on.
And
4.7.
Well, on the center as well now. Double hearts.
Ooh, where's the damage coming from? The hearts are just great against Tinker, because when you're trying to push high ground, you're going to get spammed over and over again. You get down to half health. It's a hero that doesn't kill you, he just chips at you. And once you get down low, you just back off, heal up, do the same thing over again where you just chip away at the base. So definitely the right way to itemize against a Tinker in this scenario, I'd say. It just makes it scary because someone like Axe or Tiny is going to see this, you know, almost 5,000 health Wraith King, and there's like, you know, no way do we go on this guy. He's got two lives. Same thing with Centaur. It's like, even though he's got one life, he's just too tanky. Is it worth killing him? Are we going to be able to kill him? And how much do we have to throw at him and lose to do so? He also, yeah, sitting on about 5,000 health.
Oh, no.
Got the vision.
The Tinker showing himself. Ooh, be able to force the sun. Okay. Oh! He slides his way out of there, but yeah. The Phoenix, I think he may just be dead. He'll pop the Yules, the Global comes out. Again, Phoenix in trouble.
Oh, they caught the Tinker anyway.
Oh, they
Frost
did.
Found him with the Blink.
And again, two dead without buyback. The stun's there, holding the Willow in place for the duration of the Shadow Realm. He'll pop the Cursed Crown down onto the Wraith King, but already the damage from the double edge. The right clicks of Yonison Fan are enough. Curry did get the wraparound, was able to burst down Era. But they're down three heroes. Buyback out for the Dark Willow. You are going to have Saberite getting the cool off onto the Centaur, but with the heart, he's so tanky. The root will hold him in place, but do they really have the damage? They're poking at him, but it's not even close. Yonison Fan still able to keep himself at a half health. He'll be fine. Saberlight, does he want to go in again? He's going to put the Battle Hunger down onto Central. Still 30 seconds before the Tinker's back in.
This one's to stop that heart regen kicking in, throwing the Battle Hunger, hoping that'll, you know, delay Centaur's healing a bit. But this top racks looks very, very dead.
It certainly does. A second full set of racks being taken by the final tribe. They'll play it safe as well, backing out as Eeriness come back as a full five man. Now just chill, wait it out, prepare to push for that final lane down on the bottom. So they comfortably sit 21,000 ahead. Senny is trying to play around with the Centaur, but not really a lot that he can do.
Yeah, not really a kill you can get.
He managed to get at least the Bounty Rune down bottom. The one up top there has already been taken by Yonison Fan.
Yeah. Roshan back alive, easy pickings as Chen now has an Aghanim Scepter. Just to be sent back just to get some mana back. What's happening down here? Centaur. Well, that 5,000 health coming in handy. The Stampede.
You're not killing this man. Or maybe you are.
Yeah, it's possible.
Okay, no, you are killing this man. My apologies. Let go.
Damage. That works.
Okay. Mid lane. Okay, you got the Tinker dealing with the push. He's there with the deep push on the creeps. Keep him in the base. You got the rest of the guys can get out and start to try and do some, you know, offensive plays out on the map.
So, what's next for the old Wraith?
Oh. Stable light. Gets the call, TP coming in from the Phoenix. Can they really take this fight though? It's going to be tough with the Aegis and such in hands on TFT. The Shrine is there. Dying to heal Saber right off. They'll send the Wraith King up into the air. The Phoenix pops the Supernova, but they've lost the Axe and they've lost the Egg. The BKB and the Strafe gives the attack speed that the Klingz needs to take that down in a matter of seconds. Shadow Realm TP will keep the Dark Willow safe as Curry Supreme desperately pushing out that bottom lane to try and stop TFT from getting away for more. But TFT,
Oh, I guess no, there's tier 2.
Still a tier 2.
Definitely a nice thing. They may just go for tier 4s. Yeah. Zentor can just tank tier 4s with return. Both tier 4s should die. They may not be able to throw them, but they can still do a lot of damage here.
Here we go. They jump in. Dark Willow's gone. Another hero down with that buyback for Eeriness. It's the final tribe. They've found the tier 4 towers. As you say, they don't need to get the mega creeps this game. They know they've got the strength to end game 1. As the Ancient in trouble, is there anything that Eeriness can do to put a stop to this push? There certainly isn't. As game 1 is over, the final tribe take the match.
Well played, TFT.
A decent show for it. These are players that we've never seen before.
Yeah.
Eeriness. I've never seen these guys before.
Oh, yeah. I think they look good.
They looked okay.
Definitely good signs.
I've never heard of.
For a team that has a kind of clear strategies in mind when they have that good early game. I think that's the sign of an inexperienced team. It's like, oh, we got this nice start. What do we do with it? Like, they were up maybe 1-2K gold at 10-15 minutes, had a good laning stage, but then you could see some of Tinker's inexperience. Like, he's meant to be the star player on the team. He's the highest MMR, or at least similar to their offlaner. You can't have those kind of deaths on a Tinker like that. And it's something like in pubs, he probably gets away with those plays, but in pro games, you have to play differently. The warding's going to be very different when you're in pro games. And he was getting caught out by a lot of these aggressive Chen plays and Phoenix plays. So that really cost him the Tinker death more than anything.
I mean, as I say, I didn't really believe in the Tinker, you know. Tinker, he didn't pull through.
We were both right.
What a nice way to end the day. Yep. We join forces, we agree. And we both get a point. And look at that as well. Full equality here between the play-by-play and the analyst as we end the day. Both getting 3 predictions correct out of, we had like 3 games. That's 100% prediction, I'm sure.
There we go,
100%.
Right, we did cast 3 different series. So.
Yeah, exactly. Each one of those is a series, chat. Don't you question the way we run the show. It's our show. We run it however we want. So that is game 1 of a best of 3. There's going to be more games. But I'm sorry to say, that's it for us. But I'm also happy to say you are going to have a beautiful new set of casters coming in who are going to be with you all through the night. That's right. We may have been here for you, I think, about 10 hours today. It's been a beautiful 10 hours. Thank you very much for sticking with me and Gods for this full 10 hours that we've been sat here talking to you lads and ladies at home. But now you get to hear the beautiful voices of Kips and Killer Pigeon, who are going to be with you for 12 hours. That's right. They're going to be sticking with you right from now, all through the night. In terms of what they're going to be doing, I imagine they're going to be touching on the North American Opens. Yep. Of course, they're in their day 2s. North America's going to get checked out. I guess South America's going to get checked out as well. South America. And mainly. And, of course, the rest
they'll
of
finish this best of three
here in Europe. So a lot of exciting things are going to happen. Once again, thank you very much for sticking with myself and Gods. Big shout-out to those who've been with us for the whole 10 hours. We will be back to take Kips and Killer Pigeon off in the morning so they can have a bit of a rest for tomorrow's duration of the day. As we'll be in nice and early, we'll be taking back over our shift at 8 a.m. roughly tomorrow, Swedish time, European time. And we'll be straight back in with Southeast Asia at that moment. It is, of course, going to be the start of the regional qualifiers tomorrow. We've got a great game to begin with. Lotac versus Tigers. So Raven stack against 1437 stack, basically, are those two, I think, are the big names that I pick out. I mean, there are other big players, but for me, they're the two names that stick out. It's Raven's lads against 1437 lads, for those of you who aren't too familiar with the newer teams in SEA that have been formed with different mixtures of players. So it should be a good series tomorrow.
I'm looking forward to it. Yeah. Some good games. Happy we're leaving you guys in great hands.
Yeah. Be nice to them. We've had Kips in you, so be nice to them. I'll be banning it. If you're not nice, you're getting a ban.
Particularly, you know, around hours 9 through 12. You know, you get a bit delirious. It gets a bit rough then.
They're going to do amazing. No, I absolutely know it. So once again, don't go anywhere because this show doesn't stop. We're going for another solid 50 hours at least. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. We're doing this for the Opens. So can we give that a bit of a clap? And if you're not, you get a ban. But thank you once more. This is the Corsair Dream League Season 10 Open Qualifiers for the Minor. I've been ODPixel. This has been Gods. We'll see you guys in 12 hours. But for this next 12 hours, enjoy the wonders of Kips and Killer Pigeon. They'll be with you after the break. We'll be right back.
unpredictable time. You see, I'm always ready, set to go. Follow me, it's gonna be a hell of a ride.
Watch the player's point of view with your favorite setup. Follow your favorite Dota 2 player in every detail. With the Snipe Sense, you can get direct predictions about the upcoming game. Subscribe to the Digital Pass now.
Does he always do that?
Yeah, that's kind of his thing. We'll be right back.
was born in a blizzard, my mother's only son. My daddy never saw my face, he said, you gotta move on. You gotta move on. I spend my life just rambling, I'm always on the run. Someone once tried to pin me down, but you gotta move on. You gotta move on. You gotta move on. You gotta move on. How about for a song, I fixed him with a look that said, boy, you better move on. Boy, you better move on. You better move on.
That's right. Just me. This is the European edition of Grand Grand. Oh, okay. Okay. I actually do have a caster. Hello. And how are you doing? You ready now?
No, but we're going to do it anyway.
Well, we've thrown you slightly in the deep end. You get to watch the magnificent observing abilities of Scriff with me, which means...
always a joy.
You're going to have to anticipate a lot. No clicking around the lobby yourself.
All right. Sure.
This is the main stage. This is how, well, qualifier before main stage. But, you know, this is the standard we have. We've got a big screen. We can see ourselves. Hello.
It's a bit nicer screen than I have at home. So I'm going to have to get used to that.
It is pretty flashy.
Most importantly, I can't wait to play with these.
But this is your first time on camera for a cast, right?
I've been at the summit. All the way at the start. So, I think my first proper cast was together with 343 and some of the Fnatic guys.
Oh, well, then I can't tell you anything. I mean, you're the expert here. Oh, we should probably actually... Look, we've already got heroes because some people maybe went ahead and started. So, you already got to go searching for heroes. So, do you want to start with the Wraith King?
Yes, yes. Give me a second here. I'm all tangled up. Do I take this thing off?
You can carry it with you. Like, the wires are pretty long. They're pretty generous. You'll be fine.
I'll do a little dance.
So we've got a little Wraith King with his Skelly Bros. And this is, we see this kind of opening quite a lot, right? Like, Silencer plus the Wraith King. These type of heroes, like Silencer, Venge, just lane bullies, really. Well, Venge is on the other side, but there you go.
And a very potent combination, just... starting out, because you can fill in a lot of the gaps with basically anything you want. You got your basic disables, you got your teamfight ult. It really sets you up nicely.
I mean, yeah, we were torn out this before, the previous game. It's just Silencer kind of gives you an insurance policy, but is also good aggressively. Remaining. So there's your Wraith King.
Vengeance Weaver.
Let's see Silencer as well. I say we just put more on the Roche bit. Level 1 Roche strat.
Level 1 Roche? Sure.
Let's do it.
Give Roche some companions over there.
And, you know, got a little bit of life skill in there.
Time to find all of these guys. Here's your Weaver.
Still not nerfed hard enough. Always gets picked.
Venge. Yeah, I think swapping around the talents was a nice idea, but he still has too much potential to just scale from whatever lane you put him in.
I mean, it kind of made it easier to make the talent choice, really, didn't it? It's like a little bit of strength for XP gain. It's easy.
Oh, Chikiro, that's the one that I like.
I mean, this is simplicity. I love playing this hero. Just later on, all you do is you walk into a lane, you drop Macro Pie, and you die. Like gank absorbed, lane pushed, win. Watch out. Who are you abusing there? Poor Io. Okay, come on. He got abused in the patches. Now he's being abused by Kips.
As a ball, he's made to be kicked around. He's kicking around all the time. All
right. I'm kind of concerned your approach is to kick balls. But who else? Who
only
else
when it's necessary.
We're missing Ruby. Got to get Rubik. And still need the silencer.
Man, you got to be faster for this. I get what Gods was saying about just sweating now.
It's a good workout, okay? I just sit here. Remaining. I get my energetic sides otherwise.
And I got your silencer finally. Mm. I'm dwarf juggling here with the sniper.
Wow. Way to categorize them. I mean, we could try categorize them in the future by, not alphabetically, but maybe like green, red, dwarf, dragon.
Legs, no legs.
Whoa. I all alone there. Well, Bane ain't got legs, I guess. A little bit like a Bane, though, same Spectre. Color Spectre appearing.
So they've made their bid now. They're going to say, all right, we're going to win this late. Final tribe, do your thing. Give us your worst. So do we have a Terror Blade ban? I didn't see one.
I mean, yeah.
So they can still pick it up.
Well, TB's been pretty strong, right? Didn't get nerfed. Out of all the powerhouse cores, he's the only one who didn't really get touched. Oh! Hello. Fourth pick, Brood. I mean, this is... We usually see the second pick or final pick, but fourth pick, I mean, you know, final tribe, just slap them on the table, say what up.
Yeah, both of them are ready now. I'm thinking that, well, you know me, Chikiro core, always. You could still do that, although it's not as effective anymore with the spider change now.
Well, I think Liquid tried it a few times with the qualifiers with mixed results. It's an interesting hero to run there because, of course, it's quite hard to force out a lane. It's being tanky, but yeah, especially with the change with the magic resistance on the Brood, it's problematic. You need something that can just clear with physical wave. Slardar's been seen a few times, so I'm not sure if they have room for it now.
Alright.
There you go. See, I was saying Team Green. They're on it. Like, most of the team is green. All of them if you colorblind.
Spiky heads again, maybe?
Depends on what cosmetics they're wearing. So, Necrophos, we should Necrophos. Probably keep that one close because everyone likes to bit that. Eyes open for the Pugna, maybe.
I was about to say, if we're going to see Necro, we're going to see Pugna. It's not,
I mean, it's not
again,
bad.
Is it?
No.
That is always such a risky proposition.
TFT feeling confident. One game yep. up. They're like,
there
you know
we go.
What? Take risks.
You
may now select your heroes. Eternally Undead Child has arrived. See, I'm not allowed to go help her, folks. She said this is her domain.
Yeah, yeah, this is mine. I gotta figure out this entire... I was not prepared.
up top shelves, you can see Necrophos right at the top on the right, and then one down on the right. This
you are helping me.
Look at that. I didn't enter your domain, though. You see what I done? I found
it's
a diplomatic
respectful.
Solution.
I like it. Let's see. Am I putting this with a... I can't see on the backside. Okay.
All right. We were all in the Roche bit. Look at this.
Yeah, we're just still on a level one Roche strat, right?
I mean, well, what the opponent's going to do? Is it a level one tower push? Maybe?
I don't have the overview here. Like, at this point, I am in the details. I'm with my nose in the closet, and you're going to tell me, like, the big picture.
All right, well, let's have a look here. So we've got the Wraith King. That should be the POS 3. Yeah, they're going to run it on the offlane. And then you got the Necrophos.
It's kind of hard to make the predictions if we only have
yeah,
three.
We're missing the other two. Who are the other
missing
two?
Missing Spectre.
All right, you're missing the Spectre. You know what? Screw it. Let's make our predictions. We know there's a Spectre on one side. We know the other side has a Brood Mama. All right, who's looking strong here? Because it looks like the Brood lineup is trying to finish quick.
Yeah, I'd say in this case, I'm always with the Spectre lineup. So much security in the end, and they don't have a good solution for them.
You know, I want to go against you, but I can't. I mean, there's a Weaver and Avenge there, so I'm going to be a spec lineup as well. It's looking pretty spicy. And the Pugna final pick. Come on.
Pugna final pick, yep.
Well, all right. Looks like we're ready to get in. Team's ready to spill some blood. All right, so there's that Wraith King actually going to the safe lane. But Necro does have this flexibility, right? Like, you have an escape, and you are doing a good job of making sure that you dodge the Pugna. No, he's figured out as well. He's going top. Are we running a Spectre mid here?
It looks like it.
I don't actually remember the last time I saw it. It was quite a while ago. I mean, it used to be decent.
So I guess she'd have to be running the double Stout Shield then, just like we saw the PL do a bit back?
Yeah, you start with one, then you pick the other one up because it's more efficient that way, yeah. Because they shouldn't have that many spiders to begin with.
She might actually do reasonably okay there. She's going to hold her tower at least.
Excellent idea.
Well, this is what we call the tack pause, right? We've seen a lot of those in the last day. All right. Oh, we're going back to us. Look at that. You get to stare at me hugging Puck. Puck, when is this hero coming back, Kips? Where's justice for Puck? He's upside down. But where's the justice for Puck?
A lot of really big buffs. Really big buffs. We've seen, like, you know what? When the Puck was good and you could just run it anywhere. But...
Hey, you saying he's worthless now?
Well, not worthless.
All right, so we need to say which teams we were predicting because we were saying on players. So the Spectre lineup was the Czech. No, sorry. What?
I guess the TFT? Die. You see, I can't see all the tiny.
Hey, they got Shulskhead. They got Shulskhead. Clueless. Right. So TFT are the Dire side. They're the ones with the spec lineup. So with no.
Is no,
it's the other way around. It's the other way around. All right. It's because I'm looking at purple, all right? Spectre's purple. That's how I process this. So we're saying TFT are dunzo, all right? They're not going to do this. Yeah. Rubbish.
It's interesting because I was talking a bit before this game, right? And the Czech stack looked really competent, but they had some problems with some overconfidence here and there, or some players were like, oh, we can come back now. And then way too eager, going in way too hard. And they're going to have to show a lot of reserved play now instead, because they are obviously going to be on the back foot a lot.
I guess the worry of this kind of Weaver plus Venge lane as well is you're in the lane against the Sansa. You either run him down or he builds up this attrition and just wins like that, right? So you always have to be killing him and keeping him out of the lane. But with a Wraith King as well, I mean, that's a big ask. He's going to do a lot of damage.
Also does the Weaver. And then on the other side, we actually have way more action going.
Ruby, are you going now? It's going to be the first blood. Supreme, he spills it first. So nice start. Looks like we were right to bank on that Spectre. And Necro, I think Necro is dead as well. He hasn't got Ghost Shroud. He needs to juke out in the tree line, but there's a Nether Blast and double kill for Supreme already. All right.
Yeah, that's a bad start.
That's a horrible start. I mean, that's the counter to the Necro straight away.
Yeah,
getting
I don't see it getting better at all. He's going to spend a lot of time wondering if he gets to use that Ghost Ride at all, because it's just going to kill him every time he gets it off.
Meanwhile, the mid lane, I mean, this isn't the worst case for the spec, right? You're going to get your farm, and I guess this is a unique perspective. Typically, they run it in the outer lanes. It kind of gets harassed a lot. It struggles, and you pick heroes like Lich to recover it. But if you stick at mid, that's a one-on-one, and you can get decent CS because Brood's going to be back and forth between you and the jungle anyway.
Yeah, what I'm worried about, though, is that she has no way to get the same kind of acceleration as the Brood has. So that Brood is going to move between the jungle, and the Spectre is just going to sort of stand there unless the support stack for her.
Uh-oh. Well, this problem's top again. The Ghost Shroud does come out. But Necro trying to stand his ground. It's going to be ran down here. There's the Dual Breath coming through, and Necro is going to fall again. All right.
Chikiro deals so much damage over time, it's ridiculous. You can't hit him back either because of all the attack slows.
I mean, he's losing a decent amount of health because it is a Necro, but he's losing a decent amount of health versus you dying. It's not gonna work out in your favor to continue this way.
Well, final drive of one upside to that lane there is that the lane's always going to get pushed in their favor. And here come the kills on the silencer.
Dunon's done's going out here. Which support's going to die first, though? I think Weaver's going to turn around, move over to the Wraith King. They will have a magic missile available here if they can turn around in time. There it is. On the Wraith King, going to move away. All right. So your Venge does survive. Oh, the curse? No, just out of range. The Skelly Bros can't get close enough to kill off the Venge. And Supreme, he decides to just deny himself to the tower. Is that enough of that lane? He stayed too easy. Got to give a little handicap back in return.
So for me, the bot lane is actually where this game is gonna turn. Like, top lane is a win for the Czech stack. Mid lane is a win for Final Tribe. So you look at bot as the place where the clashes are going to happen that can determine who gets to win two lanes, or if it's just even.
I think the pressure definitely comes in that mid lane. We said yes, it's going the way of TFT, but you've got this issue. Spec doesn't need the best gold to be relevant later on. Brood, there's this kind of milestones you have to achieve to stay relevant as the game goes on.
Oh, that's boring.
Do you want to use the word poor with a Necrophos? I mean, he kind of, you know, annoying era as it comes. Be honest.
It's a more poor innocence out of poor fool.
He thought he could pick this and not ban Pugnan. Rubick getting low here. They're going in on Supreme, but instead, Rubick just about staying alive. Jakiro decides he can't tank the tower. Oh, Mango up. Oh no, your ref. We got Liquid Fire. Rubick, it's going to be close to the TP. No, he ticks out. Oh, that is so painful. Not only does he still die, he has no TP to get out anywhere. It's like a long walk of shame for him.
At least the Necrophos gets some solo XP for a while, but yeah, that's a sad, sad Rubick life. And Rubick does not like being underleveled either.
He's very slow moving as well. He doesn't get back to the lane anytime soon. Hello. Spectre in the mid lane. And Jakiro just denies himself. We don't care about him. He's gone.
No.
Oh, Magic Missile on the bot lane. I don't know if they can get the Wraith King, though. He's pretty tanky. The Wraith Fire Blast comes out. They haven't leveled the Swarm yet, and that's where the kill potential comes for this lane.
I think it's more about just driving him off every time he doesn't have his support to back him up.
Supreme. Okay, there's the use of the wand. Ghost Shroud means the Necro takes a lot of damage. It's just, you can leave the Pugna alone here and he'll be just content. That hero is so fast.
Yeah, he's a great guy to make solo plays with. I would actually imagine you might want to bring the Jakiro down to mid sometimes in order to give some more security for the spec.
His Venge? No. The slow ticked out. Didn't pass the spells, after the Arcane Curse hit, but while it's happening, Pugna finally ran down the top lane. Finally, a little bit of vengeance, because this was looking pretty grim in the top lane.
Necrophos saved up all of his one charges for that one big move he just made, and the Pugna could have chosen to get some more regen in or something, but, you know, sometimes you just want to live a life on the edge.
I mean, that's more rewarding that way, come on. You want to tease the Necrophos in, give him a false sense of security, give him maybe one kill if we get cheeky. We are running into a few server issues. Dota is only a beta game. You can't expect it to always work. You know, it's only been in beta for a few years.
I mean, at this point, you know, I kind of like it that way. It just keeps you on your toes.
Keeps things spicy, you know? Like think all the games you've played in like early access, were they not funner when everything was broken? Well, not like the basic controls work, right?
Well, with the amount of pathfinding issues you've had, you might wanna.
No, we don't talk about that, okay? Like that's saying Valve and pathfinding is a bit like saying Valve and Freeze, okay? Just they don't go together. You don't do it. You know, if you can't move your own hero, that's your problem. And, well, Brood moving around his Spectre, he's dead. Okay, this lane is, I think there's an American guy that calls it dead lane. It's feeling like it's going to be the dead lane at this rate, but where do you put your Spectre? Because he can't... You can't come back here, surely. Level 7 to level 4.
You were the guy who told me that it wasn't that bad and the Spectre didn't get that much early on.
Yeah, but you need to put it somewhere. I mean, come on, kids. You can't have it be. What are you going to do? Stick the Spectre on a cliff and have it be your ward? Oh, Salve. Not saving Era there. He's still going to fall, but in return, very fire up. Weaver's staying alive, but does die to the creeps in the end. So, Era, not able to get that succulent in and make Era, you know, make Sableye a little bit stupider. But, one for one. Not bad to get that kill on the Weaver. Especially seeing as that was a worrying lane. Like, you know, we said the Venge bust the Weaver. You skirt life on the edge because you're both squishy, but you put out so much damage, even the Wraith King can't easily contend.
And Venge is pretty tanky as well. Yeah, they're just going toe-to-toe here.
Oh yeah, Venge got to fall it. All right. Era's finally getting a little bit smart here. Does get the plus two. He's going to be chased onto, though. There's this Kuchi coming through. Weaver can't go off to either of these targets. Does use a Salve. Meanwhile, in the mid lane, it's happening again. Honestly, Chessy, you keep eating so much curry. I'm a little bit worried for later on.
Spectral
Wraith Fire Blast the crit. Weaver, is he dead? He's dead. Well, they get the Wraith King afterwards, but this is what we always talk about this, right? The power Wraith King. You can nerf his Wraith Fire Blast, but guess what? If I get one crit, you suddenly lost about 30 HP, and, well, being dove in the top lane. Necrophos is going to tick out. He's got the one trying to heal him up the Ghost Shroud. Will stay alive as they back away, but they send a message. If you stay in this lane, good sir, you're going to die. Same message being sent to Kari, actually, in the mid lane. And they lift him up to Telekinesis. Chessie just trying to have a fire here. The dagger through, but Kari can't move away quick enough. This bit should come. Is he going to get the final hit? Doesn't even need the spit. Just runs him down. Activate the ult.
So this is the time where, as the check said, right, you'd have to make a decision if you actually want to take this trade. Because it is a trade. You're getting top tower, you're losing mid. Do you really want to do that? Because you're opening up so much of the map to this spider. And I'm sure you could have kept him off of your towers for at least 5 to 10 minutes longer if you would have exchanged heroes there. But they say no. We choose to play to our own advantage. We take the top lane and they can have our mid.
Uh-oh, Haunt coming in. There's a dagger through. Kari, he wants to kill into Rubick and he should be able to find Nevblast, gets it. But one thing I was going to highlight here is actually, yes, it will be inflated by the spiders, but Spectre is sitting top on last hits right now. So despite these deaths, things could be worse. Things could be looking worse for the check stack.
The loss of the map control in the mid tower is really bad because it splits your game in half, basically, and you can't move through the mid lane without either being seen or without the spider getting to harass and or kill you. Or you'd have to use your TP skills, which are on big cooldown.
Well, Necrophos in trouble. Meanwhile, in the mid lane, Weaver will be dropped by the Broodmother, but they get a kill on Necrophos in return. Ice Path's going to come out, flips onto Rubick. They can't chase through here, or can they? No, he's walking back the wrong way. They've trapped it, banged the rice. He has no way out of this. Surround on all sides, the dagger through, and the Nevblast gets the kill. They should just be able to push on the tier 1 here. They need to get some sort of tower gold, while in the bot lane, Venge is running away from the intimidating children.
Didn't the bot tier 1 also fall, or is that up?
No, that's still there.
No, well, she was just being dove.
They haven't really even tickled it yet, which is surprising when you got a Wraith King with these little skelly bros. You expect to see a little bit of damage on there by now. Yeah, it's very strong push power in the other game.
Well, that's going to happen now, because you have the Wraith King here pushing with the skeletons, mid lane's gone, and you can't easily move there anymore, because Weaver can't clean it up. So the fact that it couldn't get the trade-off on the tower top...
Weaver's dead.
TFT.
Oh, no, he gets a time-lapse just in time. They needed one more hit.
But if he stays around there,
No, they see him.
Anyway.
They got the lift. Uh-oh. They're going to reveal him moving forward. They actually don't have the dust. He might just survive this move forward. Needs one spit. Chessie can't get close enough. Weaver will survive, but barely. All right. Like, how does it feel to be one, you know, debatably strongest heroes in this early game scenario at the moment? Weaver is very dominant, right, in lane. And that's happening.
Like, that was a bug's life. Sometimes a bigger bug comes along and just squishes you.
You know, you get caught in this web of intrigue here as it hits on the tier 3. Look at the damage already. We aren't even 10 minutes into the game. Oh, Scythe in the top lane. They do get the kill on the Spectre as well. So everything looking golden for TFT in the bot lane. We're going to chase on Era here, but he's kind of out beautifully. Supreme is going to get denied to the neutral creeps. Beautifully done by him. Wraith Fire Blast does come out, and Veggie needs to move away. But the curse is there. And the body blocks. He says, eat up, my little boys. See what you get the crit through again. Magic Missile. No! Silas is still alive. Oh, Era.
You can see the desperation in those moves. They know they need to break a tower, but they couldn't go through top. Now they can't go through bottom. And it seems like our prediction is in a bit of trouble here.
Well, you know what, I thought maybe...
Time-lapse that is just as slow.
It's like, you look at this, as what could you say? Well, you might get a kill on a Rubick actually moving on to him. It's 2-on-1, but Broodmother moving across. We'll turn it around. Shakira's going to go down, and it looks like Weaver has to run for the high heel. There might be a chase, but Brood thinks twice. Not worth the time. Meanwhile, on the top, moving across. The Decrep is there on the Necrophos. They need to get across to the Nevblast. Gonna go for the TP out. They have no way of stopping him. Easy escape for TFT's Necro there.
And all the way back to bases. Maybe they get to finally punch through the top tower now, but that is not a very valuable tower right now.
I mean, they need to punch through something. The problem is, the moment you do that, Chessie's close enough that you go straight for your high ground. And that's the worrying factor, is they're always looking back at their base right now because of how this is started.
It's the one scenario where it doesn't really matter what else you do because the enemy is always holding the trump cards.
Doesn't matter what you do. Just let it happen. Let the brood exist. Let her do what she wants. Be happy she hasn't moved to your outer lanes yet.
Lie back and think of England.
whistle too. Well, Pugman getting a little bit aggressive here, but where's the lockdown? Well, there it is in return. Ray Fire Blast out onto the Pugman. Global Stance is there as well, going to try and move forward, but can't find a target right now. So, for once, the Czech stack able to walk away without casualties, but they almost lose their tier 3 in the mid lane again. This is... And what can you say about this game so far? It's just, have you seen the Broodmother show? It's on late each night.
Yeah. In the dark, the creepy crawlies come out to play.
I mean, it makes sense, right? You know, this is the natural kind of aesthetic for a Broodmother. She wants to be in her home. So she's trying to eventually reach it. She'll fountain dive in about 10 minutes. Moving in. Looks like Jagiro's going to go down. Slow so much. Decrep will protect. Can they turn around, though? The burn is hitting down the spires pretty fast. And moving forward, Weaver just jumping on to the Rubick. Might get the kill. There's the Magic Missile. Going to clean up onto the Stancer as well. So they get the support, but they more or less rotate everyone to do so.
I think it's worth it at this point, especially if the Brood doesn't prioritize regenning up here. Oh, that Nedverse is brutal.
I mean, they had to make some move. This isn't the worst one. It's you're just putting pressure on the lane, which is just being dominated by the Brood right now.
Yeah, exactly. This is probably the best tower they can get right now. They're very lucky that the wave was going this direction. But
they see the opportunity, moving on Pugman. Nope, they're going to go walk on Stabilite. Has to use the time lapse straight away again. And Wraith King moving forward. Oh, the crit comes out. They can't chase on the Pugman. No webs down, which means the Brood cannot assist right now. No man to work with right now. Dust is going to come out, we're looking to move away, and Makabar does go down. Nice. It looks like, is he going to live? Yes, he is. Just switches over the Mage Resistance and walks away scot-free, so no one falling there. They did not get the tower either, which is, that was a lot of pressure, and still not getting that tier 1. Meanwhile, top, Gary, a little bit deep here. He's going to turn around though, there's a stock, and Johansson Fine just disappears.
The threat of that Pugnav on the Necrophos will always stay, and that's one of the things that when the game is going this well, you sometimes tend to just forget. Happens to the best of us. Like, oh, I'm bullying this guy. But as soon as the pressure is off of the other place on the map, you gotta realize that they're gonna come back to haunt you. And one of the things I think was demonstrated pretty nicely there is that you don't need that many disables if you're pushing a tower. You're gonna make them engage into you. And if you want to fight, you can fight. If not, you just turn around and run away. And that is what the Czech stack did pretty nicely there. Even though they want that mid tower so badly.
Uh-oh. Diffuser comes out this time. Pugnav, the swap away. Decrep comes out. Life drain up. Stay alive. There's a stun. Global Stance is used. And the Rune lost the Pugnav. The haste should allow Rubick to move away, but barely. And in the meantime, Rubick does survive, but Venge won't be so lucky. This is... Look at him go. Run to your heart's content. Perfect time to find a haste rune.
He's making up for the time he had to walk all the way very slowly.
Yeah, doesn't have to TP away this time. Meanwhile, on the bot lane, Necro might want to TP. Doesn't have the opportunity, though. The Haunt comes out, moving forward. Slowed down. I don't think he makes out. The Dual Breath as well. Necrophos is dead again, but at this stage, you're more or less just throwing your Necro under the bus so you can do things elsewhere on the map, because Chessie's going back in again.
Oh, yeah. Like, there's two ways to play it. Basically, you have this one, where you throw the side lanes under the bus to keep pushing with the Brood. Or the other one is to take it more slowly, because if you play on their side of the map all the time, you are speeding the game up for them because distances get closer for them, and they get longer for you from all of your teleport sports.
Rubick's put a little bit deep, and he's just trying to keep all the blood in his head, but it's spilled into the river, so that's not going to work out. Stance is going to hit on the Weaver, and he's going to fall. All right. Oh, no! Just... No, he's going to live! 20 HP! Oh, you cheeky bug! No, Eric got it!
You got it?
Yeah, he ticked out. The final tick still got him. All right.
That's that superior intelligence. There you calculated.
Go. I mean, he looked fine. It looked like he wasn't ticking down anymore. It was the perfect time to try for that. But sad old Saberlight gives more gold out of the error. He's still pretty poor, though. You know, he's down there, lowest on the net worth. And highest on the net worth is about to make a move on the Pugnav again. He's going to use the Decrep. Fine, the Cypher's there, though. No damage done. Makabar does go down. Going to turn around Necrophos. Life drain. Getting him low, but not low enough. No, he stays alive. Gets the Death Pulse of the Ghost Shroud out. But he's taking out the burn. It's going to be close. He'll stay alive. Moving in. Shakira almost dead. Chessie looking across. Gets the spit out. Godlike for Chessie. He just rules this area. And Supreme Meat Chase on as well. The Magic Missile is going to come out. But Pugnav slowed down so much. Had to turn around and fight. We'll go for the TP out on the side. Looks like Venge is going to escape. But no, the spit. They got lift. Rubick moves in just in time, and they do find the Pugnav, and this might be the opportunity to go back to that high ground they've been looking for. Dire's
top tower. Oh, that was such a good bait, though, by the Czech stack. Like, they were really ready for that. They were like, all right, this is the Pugnav, this is their strongest area, this is what they want. We're going to dangle it in front of TFT. is under attack. You know, if they want it, then we might actually get that spider, but sadly, close but no cigar.
That's true. I mean, they are doing a very... Right, so for the stage of this game that they're at and the state of the lanes, Czechstack are doing very well.
They're holding on so well. I'm kind of impressed.
The kiting of this brood has been impressive. I mean, there's only so much you can do. You throw someone on the bus occasionally, but you've got to keep in mind, TFT's ahead.
The sacrifices have to be made.
That's the thing. If you get kill and return, TFT have so much money in them right now. It feels worthwhile.
Yeah, and there's... I don't know if you watched that that video that NS made recently, or if you read anything about that. But the gold calculation right now works out really in your favor if you're behind.
Ooh, nice swap coming out. Fame throws away a life. And Pugnat needs to run away quick.
That's what fringes are for, isn't it?
Yeah, Makabar goes down. Dakira's like, farm time. Give me the gold. Chess trying to move across. He just wants the opportunity to spit here. Sends to be game. He moves forward. The TP out won't make it. And now, Kari needs to be careful. Teletubbies needs to lift there, but Rubik doesn't want to chase any deeper. As Chessie's moved away on the back foot, Dakira will fall, though, as the Death Pulse will chase. And he'll either tick out to that or the Silencer. Well.
Yeah, we've been talking about how well they've been holding on, but that BKB is a game-changing item.
Oh yeah, now they can go high ground. They feel confident. The buyback forced out to the Pugnar already. Weaver's got a lot of work to do here. We'll scare him away. I feel like you just commit to getting that tier 3 at this point. Like, just break that, break the rest of the map, then go straight for the Roche Pit on the side of TFT.
If you're playing it carefully, yeah. I could actually see them hanging around a bit, just trying to get the checks to commit to, you know, the final fight. Because they seem like the kind of team that would just go for that.
You know, dangle.
And you can punish it, really.
Tasty. Yeah. Maybe dangle the brood. Maybe. I mean, she has that BKB now, so it's risky to commit. But they know how much this brood's worth. They want to get their hands on that big sack of gold, okay? They want to break bank. Oh, nice buff coming out. Catch from the Rubik. Going to move forward. The Haunt's there as well. But Shikuchi away. Says, ha ha ha. Thank you very much, Saberlight. Might be able to move across. We'll be able to find Era, but Rubik, nice Teletubbies lift, is going to cover his other support and move away himself with the Shikuchi. Era still being chased onto. Should fall here. Saberlight gets close enough. The Sun's going to come out. They might try and turn around him, but they need more assistance if they want to do so. And they'll just let it happen.
Four heroes for this.
Yeah,
and it's just four Pugnat.
They never make progress on this mid lane. The fact that the tier one is still standing for the side of TFT, and this is problematic because it means anytime you try and jump Chessie around this central area of the map, there's an instant response.
Yeah, the backup's going to be there so fast. This is what I meant with it. You slow the game down. Only if you, like, if you're TFT, you slow the game down so much if you want to, just by making them come to you, and then you can always jump them. Well. Use the long lanes. Or speed it up, go all the way to them.
So Weaver does almost have the defusal. It's not as game-changing as the BKB on the Brood.
No.
But you get some pick-off power, right, against some of these heroes. And it's not bad against the Wraith King as well. At this stage in the game, of course, mana's important for that Reincarnate. It might make him a viable target, because so far, they've pretty much just ignored him. They've let him do his own devices. And this is something you can't ignore, but what is the way in for Czech right now to stop this Roche? I feel like they know what's going on, but they can't do anything about it. They're not ready.
You don't want to at all. You're just appreciating that you've got some time and that you know where they're going to be fighting, which is in your base.
Never Blast gets a little bit of gold for his team, so Constellation Prize for giving over the Roche. But now is the problem. TFT are going to march straight into your base. So that second life on Brood, they're not worried about throwing a crap ton of gold into your lap.
It's basically never going to happen. What you'd have to do is probably kill enough of their supports and their backliners to chase them off.
There's the Macropass. You'd expect to see it moving in. The defuel's going to come out. Scares away the Venge. Goes straight for the tower. The Crep hitting on the Brood. We'll move away in time, but the tower will still fall. That's open up the base a little bit. They can just go in and start hitting on the building. Should go for the range racks first here, as it's going to be a slow siege. Pugnat just trying to push them away a little bit. Nice path connects on the two here. They might look to move forward, but they can't be too aggressive. The swap, they throw in deep. Necrophos is there. The Global Science coming out. They're going to be covered. They're going to get rid of the Venge straight away and move straight forward. The Scythe down. They'll get the kill on the Weaver. Dead Fate, 8 seconds. Spawned on the Supreme as well. He has no easy rounds. The BKB on Chessie means that you can't handle this. They will move away. Supreme barely survived. They'll turn around and hit the buildings. But now, without your Weaver, this becomes 10 times harder to hold.
They have no good answers here to get them out of the base at all. I think for that last fight, you might want to try and go for the backlines instead. See if you can sacrifice the buildings and at least get some supports and trade.
Oh, no, they found him. The stuns are there. He's dead! 70 seconds, and he doesn't have any buyback. They could just break through the whole base. I mean, the tier 2s are there, but they might even look to go for the tier 4s. They don't actually hit that hard right now, so I think they'll back away. But
well, there's still two tier 2s up, so...
Yeah, so this is like a warning, right? This is a precursor, because right now they're saying, okay, we don't actually hit buildings that hard right now in TFT, but you make that mistake again, and we're just going to end it. Because that's the stage you're at, because the next time they're going to come for your base, maybe they pick up something like a Desolator or something, like an AC that enables them to hit buildings quickly, and... If you end up in a scenario where Weaver gets scythed and the Pugna buys back and dies, what your Spectre's not going to hold. Your Spectre cannot hold this on his own right now.
Can't hold this on his own for like 20 minutes more, at least.
And he went for the Vanguard. He's got a long way to go. He still needs to get his hands on that Radiance. That's the kind of thing. If you can buy time, that's great. And this is why those tier 2s are really important for the side of the check stack, because as soon as those go down, one mistake can cost you the entire base. And mistakes made by Jakiro. It came out the scout. Maybe throws down the Magpie, gets a few of the spiders, but dies for it. Just buying a little bit more time in the middle of that, so he burns up a lot of the babies. And Jesse, he trades, I'd say that was close to even on gold, actually. For the amount he got out of that from all the spiderlings. All right, well, all right, maybe not, but does that count the gold you get from the last? I don't think it does.
Not sure, actually. Like, what I was thinking about is that this time that he spends dead is time that his team can't do anything about defending his towers in the top lane.
That's true. And he dropped the Macropass even when he's up. It's short respawn. And we usually see this as a positive for a comeback. Macropass down for 20 seconds. They could poke at the tower if they want it. But, like, you don't even feel the need to make that rush move on TFT right now, do you? Like, yes, they got Spectre, but...
And you have so much time left on this Aegis as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like Spectre's going to go farm anywhere quickly in the meantime.
The thing I said about the backstab move as well, like, with the mid-wave now always moving in, it's much harder for the Dire side to pull that off. So their options are really limited. This is the battlefield, and they're just going to have to defend it the old-fashioned way, which is head-on. And head-on is never good if you're behind.
That's kind of the worrying part as well. And you've taken the lineup that has a Necrophos, you know. You were hoping to poke up buildings like this, and instead, it's the other way around. Oh, Macropar going down, looking to actually burn up here. They might be able to get a kill. Cypher's there! No! Weaver dead again! Through the side for another 8 seconds. Chessie just goes to town. The swap's going to be out, but it won't matter. Pugna's going to fall, and Venge's going to go down as well. Spectre trying to zone them out, but it won't matter. He's been in a rock and a hard place. The buyback's going to come out from the Venge. Needs to get involved here. Wraith King still standing, looking pretty spicy. Oh, there's the Wraithfire Blast out, but Spectre pretty tanky. Silence up as well. It might be in the Global Silence is there. Spectre's going to fall, and if he goes down, this might be over. They're going to chase forward for more, and they might even look on the bench. GG comes out. They know they can't hold. The power is just too much. I mean, they gave it their best, but that Brood lane was a little bit out of control.
Yeah, I would have kind of expected them to move someone to mid faster. Because the snowball is just rolling. And you can't stop it once it gets that far. So you gotta basically do something about it before it goes wrong. But then again, you can also say about the Broodmother that the moment it goes wrong is the moment it gets picked and you think, oh no.
I mean, I don't think we were wrong to give it some credit, right? As we said, there's a Pugna farm pickup. They've counted the Necrophos. This is looking great. You know, the Spectre was an interesting call running up against the Brood, but they kind of didn't have any other choice. And you feel like with that Pugna counter and how it started, they can flip the lanes, they can take control and buy time for Spectre, but the pressure that came out from that Brood was pretty intense. I'm not sure how I feel about sending the Weaver to deal with that problem, as he learned the hard way.
I guess you want to have the Weaver there just because you want to try to get tower still with that Pugna, but maybe the Weaver would have actually had a better choice. I also think that maybe I overvalued the Spectre up against the Brood because of the relative success of the PL that we saw a while earlier.
That's true. I mean, it wasn't looking too bad from a CS perspective. The problem is, you can't just look at the CS. I mean, oh, hello. We're over there. When you die as well, you know, that gold gain is a little bit irrelevant.
And the kills they got on the sideline sort of distracted them from the fact that they could have been rotating mid instead, because their sideliners were pretty independent. You can move with that Jakiro. You can move with that Venge. You can definitely try and see if you can get some revenge on that Brood. It's not like the mid lane is suddenly forbidden or something, right? It's pretty scary to go there. But that Pugna and that Weaver can definitely hold their own for a while. And it can also push the lanes out, so you're going to actually have some darkness for your heroes to move in. So I would have liked to see a little bit more reaction to that mid lane going so wrong?
I think people's perspective, like when you look at a Brood, you're like, okay, this hero is tough, but it commits to a lane hard. And your logic is, if it has to commit to this lane hard, we can find benefits elsewhere. But the difference is that when we typically see these turnarounds where Brood gets a good start, it's heroes that can enable these early kills. And while Spectre can with a Horn, you're not enabling the kill, you're being enabled to get the kill, right? That's the way that Spectre works. You know, you set your Spectre up, you die for your carry, they get loads of gold. They're feeling pretty spicy with all the intake. But it's just... It used to... I remember like a year or two ago, Spectre mid was a thing, and it was pretty decent. Maybe not the best solution.
I've seen it picked up against some Tinkers in the past. That's pretty fun.
I mean, anything that makes Tinker's life hard is fun, right?
Yeah.
I think we agree on that.
For sure.
I think we've got like a little bit of time to burn, but I think we're moving over to SA next. I've got, what was it? Infamous versus, did I say Ursul? Yeah, Ursul. Okay. I haven't heard of Ursul, so that'll be interesting.
I haven't either.
No, I've heard of Infamous. They are Infamous by name and by reputation. They're known. What's so funny about you? You think SA is a joke, Gips? Is that what you're saying? No, you're just saying I'm a joke. I see how it is. Well, not as much of a joke as Puck, irrelevant hero.
Did you see what I have here?
Sorry. Irrelevant hero. Get rid of him.
No. It's like, I believe.
Is it your dream that Tide will one day be relevant as a right clicker?
As a right clicker.
Come on, level 25 talent, right? Spin it around. Come on.
I'm just especially sad about the fact that this man needs a little bit of comeback time in the jungle sometimes. And then when the ancients just do their whole root and minus armor shebang.
I feel more sorry for Sven on that one. I mean, Aeon Disc and those creeps, that's pretty scary. But you know what else is scary? Time without us on screen. No, that's actually a blessing, actually. You guys are going to get a little bit of a break before our next match. So, Ursul versus Infamous as we move into the SA and NA matchups. Lots to watch there. I mean, NA is its own special brand of special. That's how I usually define UK dub, but, you know, it's like NA. NA's got its own spicy thing going on as well.
The grandchild of England, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, they picked up the worst from us. And then SA, of course. SA is always pretty competitive, actually. In fairness, like even... I remember the TI qualifiers. It looked like anyone could take it.
I am so looking forward to that, actually.
Well, we're going to go to a short break. I'm going to restock on drinks. And hopefully not too long before we're back with Ursul versus Infamous, guys.